Because they don't know when you can come back.
So
I've given you a license to stay a long time. Can't leave.
So, dear devotees, for your servant, everything started in the year 69. It was in Paris, and Srila Prabhupada had just sent some devotees from America in Paris. There was only one French devotee called Souridas, and the others were American or Canadian. And they were sleeping under the bridges of the Seine in Paris. Maybe one was staying in a hotel, and the others were trying to meet people who could host them for the night. They had no money whatsoever, just the instruction of Srila Prabhupada to come to Paris and spread Krishna consciousness. So at the time, it was our first year in a university with one friend that some of you may know, Jyotirmayi, and the other was Ilavati. We were friends from high school for a long time. And after testing, you know, everything crazy the youth at that time could test, we became very dissatisfied with material life. And we came to a point, we wanted to know what was life about, what was the goal of life, especially for the human form of life, and what was happening after death. You know, was everything going to be finished? Just going to complete forgetfulness? Or was it going to be something happening after death, you know, making all the lessons of this life worthwhile? And we came to a point, we were looking for a spiritual teacher. So we took some free courses in university, a university called La Sorbonne. It was ethnology, because we wanted to find an answer in the way the ancient civilization were talking about the absolute truth, the goal of life. But we became very dissatisfied, because one of our teachers who was teaching all the Chinese philosophy, Taoism, we asked him, would you like to go to a monastery, you know, in Tibet or wherever you can, to try to practice what you're teaching? And his answer was, oh no, it is just my job. So we became very, very dissatisfied. And after trying to find out where to go to find a spiritual master, should we go to the Eskimo? Should we go to the tribes of Africa, to China? We decided to try to go to India. We had a teacher. He was a sannyasi from India, teaching impersonalism Vedanta. And he was teaching us aphorism of the Vedanta, telling us, you are that. And we thought it was so great, you know. We could speculate all our life, you are that. So we were very enthusiastic. And we decided to go to India, but we had to do a little student job. Then we did a little job to distribute leaflets, publicity leaflets in mailing box. And in our team, we were taking a bus, like a van every morning. And the team was in the van. And there was one boy. He was French, a young boy coming from America. He had a little tuft of hair at the back. And he saw us reading all these impersonalist books. And he said, Are you interested in spiritual life? We told him, we are just living for spiritual life. Then he said, oh, I have a spiritual master. His name is Esi Bhaktivedanta Swami.
Haribol.
So we told him, we are just looking for a spiritual master. We're ready to go anywhere to find one, but it has to be a bona fide spiritual master, not a cheater. And then he told us, there is a scripture called the Srimad Bhagavatam. You open it, and you are free from the cycle of birth and death. And as a neophyte in personalist, we told him, oh, we just want liberation. Then he told us about the Maha Mantra. You just take these beads and you chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So we were very attracted by the Maha Mantra. And when we went home, we chanted the Maha Mantra in front of a picture of Lord Buddha. And it worked very well. So
it worked well.
Oh, so well, so well.
Introduce this now. We'll introduce this system. Of,
yeah.
Picture of Lord Buddha and chant.
Maybe. And then the devotees told us, we have a program at the American Center. It's near Montparnasse, for those of you who know Paris. Every Sunday, please come. And of course, you know, our youth, the generation of our youth was young in the 60s. So the 60s, the youth was very rebellious. We didn't want to live the life our parents were living. In French, it was called, the life our parents were living was called métro, boulot, dodo. Meaning to take the tube early in the morning, then to go to work, to get exhausted, and at night, just to fall asleep, not having any time to reflect on any existential questions of life. So we thought better die than having a life like that. At that point, the young people were thinking, there is something else in life than gross matter. And they were experiencing some process brought by a professor in university, an American university, called Timothy Leary. And it was using some chemical drugs to try to transform the perception the gross senses were giving to the human being. So we were no different. And before going to the session of the devotees, we thought we have to see if these devotees, they are real spiritual people. So we took some of these chemical drugs known as LSD to test the devotee. We thought in our foolishness, we will see the truth. We will see if they are actually true spiritual people or cheaters. So we came with big eyes to the American Center. And Krishna really tricked us. First, we heard the kirtan, and the devotees were looking like angels. This kirtan was so melodious. We were already chanting Hare Krishna, and it was extremely, extremely angelic. So I looked at my friend, Jyotirmayi, and we agreed, yes, they are spiritual people. But Krishna tricked us even more. When we looked at the audience with our distorted perception, we could see that the people sitting had had heads of animals. They were looking like cats, dogs, and asses. So we thought it was really strange, but then we thought, yes, the devotees, they are real spiritual people. Let us try to practice this process. So very, very shortly, they told us, actually, our spiritual master is going to open a temple in London. Why don't you go and meet him? So we told him, we told the devotees, yes, why not, actually, because we are ready to go to India. And in our, in the foolishness of our 19 years, you know, being on this earth, we were very proud and we thought, let us go to London and let us test this spiritual master. Let us see, we have to be very careful, let us see if he's not a cheater, if he's a bona fide spiritual master. But Prabhupada tricked us. So we came on a very, very special day in that very mythical temple called Sevenbury Place. Our dear Chananda Swami knows very well Sevenbury Place. And the beautiful deities, Sri Sri Radha Nandanishwara. Of course, all the deities are extremely beautiful. And as you said yesterday, the minister of deity worship said, Balaram is the most beautiful deity he ever saw on the planet. But also, Srila Prabhupada was very, very fond of Sri Sri Radha Nandanishwara. He said, Krishna has cheated you. He didn't come as a murti. He came himself. And also the minister of deity worship said, they are the original deities in ISKCON. All the other deities are expansion of Sri Sri Radha Nandanishwara. So they transformed our lives, Sri Sri Radha Nandanishwara. And we can be witness that Krishna is not a murti, he is Krishna himself, also like here, but especially there we made the experience. So we came to that place after traveling by boat, and when we came, the girls, we were dressed in civil clothes, so they thought we were looking, you know, with long hair, and maybe they thought we were looking like Maya Devi. So they put us a sari, they put our hair properly. And by the time we went up, that was a special day because it was the installation of Sri Sri Radha Nandanishwara on December 14th. Now we celebrate as Odan Shastri. And we missed that very extraordinary installation where a lot of Leela happened. And we just came after that. When we came in, there was a beautiful, beautiful kirtan led by Yamuna Devi. Mukunda Prabhu at the time was at the Mridanga. And it was so melodious again. Then we sang with the devotees, and all of a sudden, all the devotees felt flat on the floor. So we did not know why, but we were quite young, polite girls, so we did the same. But I got very, very curious. Srila Prabhupada said one of the defects of the ladies, like men have defects, ladies have defects, and one of the womanly defects is to be curious. So is it true? Yeah? And the boys, are you curious? Yeah. Also? Yeah. Okay. So then I was curious. Yeah, I was very curious. So I put my head up a little bit, and I saw two beautiful golden feet passing by my head. And it was a very amazing experience. I wanted to see more. I put my head up, and for the first time, I saw Srila Prabhupada. And it was such a scene, extraordinary, because, you know, Prabhupada physically was not very tall, but he looked immense, because he was very straight and very aristocratic. His head was just, you know, very elegant, very, very, very aristocratic. And he, at the same time, in the same second, he looked like the most humble sage in the world. So it was actually two antinomic qualities in the same person, very rare to find. Then Srila Prabhupada walked near the deities. The deities were at the back of a narrow, I would say narrow, temple room. And the Vyasasana at the time was near the altar, on our right, facing the altar. And Srila Prabhupada sat on the Vyasasana very, in a very regal way, very elegantly. And he started to pick the kartal. First, you heard, all of you, you heard, the tempo was very slow, very meditative, very grave. And after some time, the speed was picking up and it became mellow again. Then time came for the class. And for the class, Srila Prabhupada was talking about the philosophy, and something very mystical happened to Jyotirmayi and me. Our English was just school English at the time, and we didn't understand what the devotees were talking about. For example, our temple commander, I will call him Prabhu, because at the time he was Brahmachari, it was Tamal Krishna Prabhu.
Krishna.
Yeah. And when he was saying, instead of answering yes, we were answering no. But when Prabhupada spoke, we understood every word, absolutely every word. And more than that, and a lot of my brothers and sisters will tell you the same, we didn't ask the questions, but he was answering all our questions before we could actually ask. So the first day was very, very mystical. And every evening, we had a little ritual with Jyotirmayi, who was at the time Joël, and I was Monique. So we had a little ritual. We would talk in French, so nobody could understand. And we were asking ourselves, est-ce que vous pensez que Srila Prabhupada, est-ce que tu penses que Srila Prabhupada est notre vrai maître spirituel? Do you think Srila Prabhupada is our real spiritual master? And we became more and more attracted day by day, but we were still, we were so polluted by impersonal philosophy that we were not convinced straight away. So then, Prabhupada gave a lecture. He actually stayed that time from when we came only 7 days after the installation of the deities. And then he gave a lecture, he talked about initiation. Next day he was going to give initiation. He said, initiation is the beginning of spiritual life. And I became very attracted by him. And next day we were actually taken to Srila Prabhupada's room. It was about only 15, no more than 20 devotees in the temple. I wanted to ask Srila Prabhupada for initiation, but I already had been 2 days, you know, it was my second day. So I asked Srila Prabhupada, I was a little shy, and I asked him, Srila Prabhupada, I would like to start spiritual life. And then he looked at me with a big smile. He told me, but you're already practicing spiritual life. You're cleaning Krishna's dishes, you're sweeping Krishna's floor. Then I thought, oh, this is spiritual life. And later on, Yamuna Devi told us, when we came to the temple, Srila Prabhupada had asked Tamal Krishna Prabhu, why don't we initiate these nice French girls? And then he said something he could say from all the ladies in the room. He said, they are like flowers blowing in the wind. Prabhupada is such a poet, a kavi. And but then Tamal Krishna Prabhu told him, but Prabhupada, they are not ready. So Srila Prabhupada says, okay, we'll wait a little bit. Then the next day, we were told again to go to Srila Prabhupada's room. And Prabhupada, I remember, came and he asked me, what is your name? And since I didn't take part in the initiation, I told Srila Prabhupada, but Srila Prabhupada, I have no name. So he looked at me very surprised. And then he understood. And he said, oh, you don't like the name your parents gave you? And he had a big, big smile. And to me, that smile meant, don't worry, I will give you a name you will like. So now I'm going to jump in time. And we are going to talk about a name in the initiation. And maybe my brothers and sisters, they would like to share about their names if there is anything. So in the temple, when time came later on, maybe 1 month after for initiation, I had in the temple the two devotees I really loved very much. One was my, she told me everything, you know, it was Yamuna Devi. And the other, he was like a big brother to us. At the time, he was Trivikram Brahmachari. He was like a big brother, he was protecting us. We used to go on Harinam at night in the Soho district, where everybody was drunk. And he was a little older than us, but at the time very old. He had been going to the Vietnam War, you know, so he was protecting us. And Yamuna Devi, she's so wonderful. So I was thinking, what kind of name Srila Prabhupada is going to give me? And I thought, oh, I would like to have the name of a river like Yamuna. You know, it was like a thought like that, a quick thought. And then at the time, Prabhupada was traveling the world, so we used to receive our beads and our name by letter. It was a little blue aerogram, very thin blue paper at the time, because, as you know, we had no cell phone. There was one phone in the temple, you know, with big letters and numbers. And so it came with this blue aerogram, and I read, my dear daughter, Mandakini Devidasi, I'm very glad to accept you, you know, as my disciple, and I'm glad that you are appreciating the bliss of Krishna consciousness. Because we had to send a letter to Prabhupada to tell him why we wanted to be initiated. So I told him, you know, I was very, very neophyte, and as we will read a letter with Gajendra in the Srimad Bhagavatam, actually, now when we become a little mature, we have a lot of gratitude when Krishna is sending us the difficulties and tests. It's a way to progress. So we thank the Lord with gratitude for difficulties, although we don't ask for them, but they come anyway. So we thank the Lord. But at the time, I didn't think of that, and I told Prabhupada, I'm appreciating the bliss of Krishna consciousness. We were going on Harinam three times a day, and sometimes my friend Jyotirmayi, one time she fainted, you know, on Harinam. And so there was a bliss, such a strong bliss. Then he said, your name is Mandakini. This is the name of the Ganges River, flowing in the heavenly planets. And I felt, oh, Srila Prabhupada gave me the name of a river like Yamuna. And I was so, so happy. And then I learned that this name of the Mandakini River is linked to Lord Vamanadev. You remember the dwarf incarnation who begged three steps of land from King Bali. And then King Bali became huge. He assumed a gigantic form to beg the three steps of land. And in one of the steps, he made a little hole in the covering of the universe. And the Mandakini River, who was flowing in the heavenly planets, came on Earth, became the Ganges River. And we know the story was caught by Lord Shiva, etc., etc. But when Lord Vamanadev assumed that gigantic form, he became Trivikram. So Prabhupada linked me with these dear devotees, fulfilling a small desire I had to have the name of a river. Somebody asked Srila Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada, do you know everything? He said, I just know what Krishna wants me to know. And as devotees, when we have some desires that are not detrimental for our spiritual life, Krishna and the spiritual master easily can fulfill these desires if they are not detrimental for our spiritual growth. Isn't it? Yeah.
You may mention that Trivikram is now who he is.
Is?
They may not know. Ever
oh, he's a sannyasi now for a long time, and he's a spiritual master. Anything else? He's. His name?
Yeah, that was the question. What was his name?
His name was Trivikram. I don't know his name now, if he has changed.
Trivikram Swami.
Trivikram Swami.
He's an oldest sannyasi who's gone.
Yes, yeah. In the very beginning, he was a little older than us, you know. And at one point, he asked Prabhupada if he should get married, and Prabhupada told him, you are too old. Yeah. So then I'm going to share a story about somebody, you know, about a name, because it's a very funny story. It's a, you know, it's a Kishori story about name, Kishori story. She's unique in her own, there is not, you cannot find two Kishoris in the movement. She's very unique. so she decided to get initiated. And then she came with a devotee from New Zealand. And she asked the devotee, what kind of name would you like? And the devotee said, they were in Amsterdam. The devotee said, I don't want any other name than the name of a cow. and then she asked Kishori, who was then Geraldine, she asked, and you, what kind of name do you want? And then she said, I don't want any other name but the name of a gopi. So they come to London, and Kishori has an idea. She has a lot of ideas. And she says, okay, let's go to an Indian shop. We have to make Prabhupada understand what kind of name we want. So she didn't know, but the names were already chosen. You know, it was written, the names were written, and the beats and everything. But they didn't know. So they go to the Indian shop. Kishori is buying a big bracelet, ankle bracelet, with big bells. She's giving to the girls. She says, you put that on your ankle, and when you will walk, it will make a lot of noise, and it will remind Prabhupada of the cows in the fields, you know? And so the girl put the bracelet in the on the ankle. And then Kishori, she's buying big opulent skirts, silver, gold, and a lot of jewels, and it makes a lot of noise. She's putting kajal, gopi dots. And if you see pictures of the ladies at the time, we have no makeup, no jewels. We have just tilak, head covers, with a saffron piece of cotton for sari, very austere. So they come to the temple, and the devotees are quite surprised. And it makes noise. And then Prabhupada comes, he sits, and he starts calling the names. And he's calling the name of that lady from New Zealand. So she comes, and it makes a lot of noise. So she's asking, what are the four rules and regulations? Tell, like we are with Prabhupada. So what are the four rules and regulations? You can? Oh, a lady, maybe, a lady. It will be more like a drama. I know it's hard to be. Yeah. She says like that. Then he gives the beats. He gives the beats. And he says, your name is Surabhi Devidasi, the greatest cow. And she's so happy. She got the name of a cow. And then it's actually Kishori's turn. So she stands up. And she's all, you know, and she makes the eyes like to Prabhupada like that. So Prabhupada looks at her surprised, you know. And it's not the last time he's going to be surprised about Kishori. And she sits down. She offers obeisances first. Prabhupada is asking, what are the four rules and regulations?
No meat eating, no intoxication, no gambling, no illicit sex.
Yeah. So Srila Prabhupada takes the beads, he gives the beads, and he said, your name is Kishori Devidasi, the highest gopi, Srimati Radharani. And would you like to share, Maharaj? Any of the ladies would like to share? Anybody else?
Yeah, here.
Please. Do you? Should we?
Yeah. What are you asking?
Your name. Yeah. Come close. If it's not long enough.
I would just like to preface, because you mentioned when you first saw Srila Prabhupada, and I first saw Srila Prabhupada in Rue Lissier in Paris, 6e arrondissement, and I won't go into the whole story, but when Srila Prabhupada walked into the room, we had made a Vyasasam for Prabhupada that was at the back of the Vyasasam was round, and it was just covered in yellow cloth. So it looked like the sun. And when Prabhupada walked into the room, as you said, he had a very small stature. I was not expecting that because we didn't have internet and pictures or anything like that, so I didn't know. I just knew what Prabhupada's face would look like. And he just glowed, absolutely glowed like the sun. I was completely not expecting, and it was just such an enormous presence in the temple room as he walked just very gently through the devotees and then sat on this sun-shaped vyasasa. So that was my very first recollection of seeing Prabhupada just radiating that golden light. So anyway, coming to my initiation, that's why I wanted to. I joined the temple in Paris, in Fontenay-aux-Roses, and Montecchini was the first devotee to meet me. Indra Dumna he met me at the Louvre Museum, and after speaking to me for a few moments, he said, Montecchini, come this, talk to this nice girl. And so Montecchini and Indra Dumna took me back to the temple in Rue Lesueur. So thank you, Eva, in my eternal gratitude to you, Montecchini. So, yes, my name. The initiation ceremony, I was with my dear friend Merida and Somaka and their brother Swastika. They were Italian devotees. We all joined at the same time, them a month earlier than us, than me. They came to Rue Lesueur because there was no temple in Paris, in Italy, and they wanted to learn.
For the translation, a little slower for the translation.
Oh. And so, and also there was one Italian devotee in Rue Lesueur who was Ali Krishna.
Oh, yes.
And Jyotir Mai was also, and Yogeshwara, they took me under their wing. And so when they came to the initiation ceremony, Prabhupada called Merida first, and he asked her, what are the four regulated principles? And Merida was Italian. She was beginning to learn French. She didn't understand English, especially she didn't understand Prabhupada's English. And she was a very gentle, modest, humble devotee. And she just stood beside Prabhupada's vyasasana, very petite person as well. And she shook, she was, and then Prabhupada looked at Hamasaduta, who was his secretary. She doesn't understand. And Ali Krishna stood up and she translated for her. And so Merida immediately told Srila Prabhupada what was the four regulated principles. And Prabhupada said, your name is Mridanga Das. And so he looked at Hamasaduta, he said, this is not a brahmachari. her birth name was Mara, so they didn't know that it was female. So he looked at her and he said, your name is Merida. That is the clay that the Mridanga is made from.
So beautiful.
So that was how Merida received her name, and then he called me. And I went up and I stood beside the Vyasasana. Nobody had prepared us for what was going to happen at this initiation ceremony, but we were beginning to pick up that the four regulative principles was part of it. And Srila Prabhupada looked at me and he said, you know? And I froze. What hadn't they told me? What am I supposed to know? I absolutely didn't know how to reply to Srila Prabhupada. And he turned to Hamasaduta, he said, she is also foreign. He said, no, Prabhupada, she's English. And then he hissed, Hamasaduta hissed, what are the four regulated principles? Oh, I know that. So when you asked me just now, I really felt compelled. And then Prabhupada said, your name is Bhogini. And all the devotees went, Rogini, he died. And Prabhupada said, Bhogini. It's a Rogini. Okay, but it's not functioning. And So yes, that is how I received money. And then later on, Pradyumna had been performing the fire yagya. And later on I asked him, so who is Bogini? And I think he said, I'm a little confused because it's different times I've received my name. He said, oh, he translated it to himself from Sanskrit.
Mm.
He says, Boga means to enjoy, Ini is the feminine form, therefore it must be one of the names of Radharani.
Oh,
so
beautiful.
Devi Dasi.
Hannibal.
And then I just will add, because it is an unusual name, I don't believe there are any other Boginis in the world.
Yes.
Boginis and, you know, all sorts of other similar. But later on, Shivaram Swami and Keshav Bharati were walking around the manor, and they stopped one day and they said to me, Bogini is one of the names of one of the wives of one of the cowherd boys of Vrindavan. Okay.
Thank you.
Talk about names. Sure.
Please.
Who else do we have? Gopaswami Prabhu is here. Who else? We see the name for Prabhupada. Gopaswami Prabhu. Anyone else here? We see the name from Srila Prabhupada. Vishesha is not here.
Paramagati. Paramagati.
Hare Krishna.
Tell me one thing, if I can ask a question. Were you in Bury Place in 1971?
Let's see, yes.
Most of the year?
I probably left in... wait. When did Prabhupada come back to Russia? He went in June to Moscow. Maybe in September. I can't remember, maybe I already went to Paris.
Hmm.
Not sure.
Mm-hmm. That was the first time I came to Bury Place, was in September 71.
Not sure completely.
Yeah, Prabhupada had just left. He'd been in Bury Place, he just left.
Oh, maybe I was then.
Yeah, I think so, because my vision is that you were the first devotee who opened the door when I arrived there.
Oh, yeah.
Someone with a French accent and a,
I didn't lose it.
I won't tell the story of the first day, but the name, initiation, etc. In London, I was visiting as a guest for some time. Now, I joined in early 72 in Bury Place, and Prabhupada was coming in July 72 to London for the Rathi Ashram. So. The initiation in London, 2 years in a row, was very unique because Prabhupada came in 72 and 73 for Rathi Ashram. And initiation was, usually initiations in Paris, you had it in the park also.
Jardin du Luxembourg.
In London, those 2 years, the initiation was on Trafalgar Square. Quite amazing. If you've been to London, you know what is Trafalgar Square. And Prabhupada gave initiation 2 years in a row on Trafalgar Square. And in 72, there were a lot of devotees. I don't know if any of you were there. Were you there, Bogie?
No, I was in France by that
time. In 72, you were in France. Yeah. Well, the French devotees came over. So, and the devotees came from Amsterdam, I think. I'm not sure, but a few other countries, maybe Germany, a few devotees came over for initiation. So there were quite a few devotees, and it was at the end of the Rathiatra,